Shining through the dark. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. If you'd like to be seated, please. We gather this morning in great sadness to offer the funeral mass together for Mary. We're now going to place onto her coffin the Christian symbols. I'd invite Philip now to place the cross, the reminder of Christ's suffering and death, the reminder that he died for us to open the gates of life to those who believe in him. I then invite Teresa to place the book of the Gospels. Mary lived her life in obedience to the Gospel of Christ. Her values were Gospel values, and for that we give thanks. We're now going to bring forward to the altar some symbols of Mary's life, symbols of her life and interests, and Paula is going to explain the significance of those things to us as they're brought forward.
Killian brings a family portrait which represents Mary's love and devotion to her family. Matthew brings Mary's hiking stick and hat as a symbol for her great love for travel and hill walking. Laura brings a nature bouquet, which reflects Mary's love of her flowers, garden, and nature. Eve brings a Dublin and a Kilkenny flag, representing her love of Dublin football from her childhood growing up in Dublin, and love of hurling and camogie from her long life lived in County Kilkenny. Emily brings a book which represents Mary's love and involvement in all of her grandchildren's lives. And Hilda brings Mary's oven gloves and apron, which represents her love for home baking and gathering people around her table. Visitors always received a warm welcome.
So let's stand together to join in prayer. So to prepare ourselves to celebrate this Mass worthily together for Mary, let's begin with an acknowledgement of our own failings. We have a God who is ready to forgive, we have only to ask. So let's quietly now turn to him and, admitting our faults and failings, ask for that forgiveness. Together we pray. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who have set a limit to this present life, so as to open up an entry into eternity, we humbly beseech you that by the grace of your mercy, you may command the name of your servant Mary to be inscribed in the book of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. You be seated now, and John and Emer are going to do the readings for us. And between the two readings, the psalm will be sung.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will prepare for all peoples a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he will remove the mourning veil covering all peoples and the shroud unwrapping all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He will take away his people's shame everywhere on earth, for the Lord has said so. That day it will be said, "See, this is our Lord, in whom we hoped for salvation. The Lord is the one in whom we hoped. We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. As for me, my life has already been poured away as libation, and the time has come for me to be gone. I have fought the good fight to the end. I have run the race to the finish. I have kept the faith. All there is now to come is the crown reserved for me, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but to all those who have longed for his appearing. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia, in thanks to the most holy. Alleluia, alleluia, in praise to his name. Jesus has died and is risen. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to the risen one. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to his name.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If there were not, I should have told you. I'm going now to prepare a place for you. And after I have gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Be seated, please. It's just 5 weeks ago since we were gathered here in this church to say farewell to Mick. And on that occasion, Mary was too unwell to be with us. And I think if we're honest, we all of us back at that time felt that this day wouldn't be too long in coming. I think there's a sense in which we can all share a sense of relief about Mary's death. Because in recent times, her illness had robbed her of any real quality of life. And her death can truly be described as a happy release. She died surrounded by the family she loved, in Mike's house, having enjoyed the best of care and attention. And the care that she was shown was indeed truly exemplary. And I know I shouldn't single anyone out, but I know that Emer had a very special place in Mary's heart. And the care she showed her was truly something exemplary. On one of my visits some months ago, when Mary was much more lucid, she expressed to me how blessed she felt to have such a caring, wonderful family around her, for the love that was shown her. To be the mother of 10 children takes a lot of stamina and a very big heart. And Mary had both in abundance. Her life's journey began in her native Drumcondra. Almost 90 years ago, she would have been 90 at the end of December. She herself was from a family of 10, 7 boys and 3 girls. And her passing marks the end of that complete generation. She's the last of the Conways to go, as indeed Mick was the last of the Stapletons. An era has truly come to an end. Mary's life, having begun in Dublin and grown up there, was to change completely when she met the love of her life, Mick, was to relocate with him here to Ballyragget. And this has been her home for the vast majority of her years. It was a big change for a city girl from Drumcondra to come down to a farm in what we thought at the time was the middle of nowhere in Ballyragget. It was a big change, but it was one that she adapted to very quickly and very well. She took like a duck to water. She enjoyed her life and enjoyed all that made it up. Whenever we spoke about Mary, it was never singular. It was always Mary and Mick or Mick and Mary. They were like two sides of the same coin. You couldn't think of one without the other. She took to country life as a true natural. You know, they say that opposites attract, and I think there's some wisdom in that. Because speaking yesterday with John, he described his mum and dad as complete opposites, and in many ways they were. Mick was outspoken. He called a spade a spade. If he'd something to say to you, it was said directly, without compromise. He was blunt. Mary, on the other hand, well, let's say she had more refined diplomatic skills. She was altogether more subtle, but nonetheless effective. She could get her point across in different ways. Claire recalled to me how her mam never spoke, she never heard her speak in anger or annoyance. And a word she used of her was, she was a peacemaker. Now, in any large family, you know, it's never like the Waltons all the time. There are fallings in and fallings out, there are disagreements, there's all kinds of ups and downs. And Mary was usually the one to broker the peace. She was the one to make the gentle approach and the suggestion that maybe an apology might be called for. And you know, it seemed to work, because here we are all together today, and they're still a close family. Of course, I'm very conscious today that young Mary, as my mother used to call her, is not with us today. I know she's joining us on the internet. She's on the other side of the world visiting her son, Liam, whom she hadn't seen in a number of years because of COVID. And it must be difficult for her being separated by the miles. But although separated from us in distance, she's very much united with us in prayer. And she is at the heart of our prayers too today. Mary's life, like Mick's, was very much family-centred. And I think that's something she carried over from her own happy childhood in Dublin. One of my earliest memories as a young child is of coming here to Ballyragget with Mary's mother, my grandmother, the Granny Conway. We came down on the train and got off at the little station that used to be here, and Mary met us in the trusty old Volkswagen and took us up to the Grove. I think I was about 6 years old at the time, because my grandmother died in 1961. One of my other memories is of coming here to this church on a Sunday morning to First Mass, as they used to call it. And what sticks in my mind of those days is that when we arrived, there was a stream of people coming from all directions. It seemed the whole town turned out for Mass. How times have changed. During those early years, Mary, of course, raised her family, and she gave that task 100%. It takes a lot of hard work and dedication, and as I said earlier, stamina, to rear 10 children. Mary was supported in that task by her deep religious faith. She was a woman with a profound trust in God, and that's something she had from her earliest years and carried with her throughout her life. I went rummaging last night in a box that I keep with a few of my mother's belongings. I found this little prayer book, and it has an inscription on it. It says, to Peg, that's my mother, her sister, from Mary, Christmas 1952. 70 years ago, that was her Christmas gift to my mother. I doubt that many prayer books are given as Christmas presents in 2022. But there were different times. There were times of great faith. But Mary's faith was never something that was just empty piety. It was never just words. Because her faith fashioned her way of life, her whole attitude, her approach to people, her openness, her generosity. Mary always looked for the good in others. She never focused on their faults or their shortcomings. So many people enjoyed her hospitality. Nobody went away from the house without a cup of tea and a slice of the famous apple tart that she was famous for. Father Eamon has been visiting Mary over the last few years, bringing her the Blessed Sacrament and spending time with her. And I know the family would like me to express gratitude to him for that, for the care and attention that he showed her. In the late 1980s, Mary discovered a new passion in life. She always enjoyed walking, and she joined a hill walking group. And over the next few years, each October, they set out for different European countries and climbed mountains and hills. And she told me on many occasions of the adventures that they had and the great enjoyment. But of course, there was a problem. Mick was a homebird. He didn't see the need for travel. So he was only told on a need-to-know basis. Usually the trip was only divulged a day or two beforehand to minimize the moans and the groans. But the moans and the groans were a surface thing, because when she returned home, he loved to hear the accounts of what had happened and the good times she'd had, and entered into the whole joy of the trip. Of course, Mary's pride and joy were her grandchildren and her great-grandchildren. And she liked nothing better than hearing from them about their lives and their adventures. And she took great pride in their achievements. John said this morning, he said, whereas we as kids growing up told her nothing, the grandchildren were more forthcoming and told her everything. And she enjoyed greatly that sharing with them. So looking back over the last 90 years of Mary's long life, there's much to be grateful for and to give thanks to God for. Here was a life well lived, and a life lived to the full. A long life, a happy marriage, a family that she took pride in and had the joy of seeing grow up and seeing her children's children and their children. And as we bring the curtain down on that life today, we do so with a great sense of thanksgiving. We pray that even as we're here in sadness now, Mary's already entered that fullness of joy in God's presence. May she rest in God's eternal peace. Amen. Let's think on Mary for a few moments now, remembering the woman she was, and ask the Lord now to be gracious to her, to take her to himself. We stand together now, and I invite some of the grandchildren to come forward, and we're going to have our prayers of the faithful. So we turn to our Heavenly Father, and in the face of death, we remember he is the author of life, and we ask him to hear and answer these prayers, which we bring before him with confidence.
We pray for those that care for the sick and dying. We pray for the doctors, nurses, and carers, especially those who care for Nana. We also pray for the home care team who were so kind to Nana and us as a family in her final hours. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for the deceased members of the Stapleton and Conway families. We pray today especially for Grandad, in the hope that he is reunited with Nana. We remember Nana and Grandad's sons, Tom and Liam, and grandchildren, Niamh, Anita, and Mary. We would also like to remember Grandad's sister, Lockhate, who has recently passed. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray the Lord will have mercy on Nana. May the angels lead her into paradise, and until we meet again, may God hold her in the palm of his hand. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For our family and friends who are gathered here today to remember Nana, may they be consoled in their grief and comforted by great memories. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those who cannot be with us today, especially Mary, who couldn't come back from Australia. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. Mary had a great devotion to our Blessed Lady. We ask Mary, the Mother of the Lord, now to intercede for Mary as we say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Heavenly Father, hear our prayers and grant what we have asked in faith through Christ our Lord. Amen. You be seated now, and Mary and Bridget are going to bring forward the gifts of bread and wine. Pray then, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant Mary, on whose funeral day we offer you this sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to her, or any human fault have affected her, it may, by your loving gift, be forgiven and wiped away. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned. The sadness of death gives way to the bright promise of immortality. Lord, for your faithful people, life is changed, not ended. When the body of our earthly dwelling lies in death, we gain an everlasting dwelling place in heaven. And so, Father, with all the saints and angels, and all the hosts and powers of heaven, we proclaim your glory as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit. You give life to all things and you make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts that we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate this Eucharist. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. When supper was ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, and he gave the cup to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world. Save us, Savior of the world.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, the Saint Patrick, Saint Mary, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church here upon earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Bishop Dennis, our Apostolic Administrator, the Order of Bishops, all who are called to ministry in your church, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant Mary, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who is united with your Son in baptism may also be one with him in his resurrection. For from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly bodies after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. There every tear will be wiped away from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall become like you. And for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Jesus Christ, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. We stand together now, united in faith as the one family of God, and we pray for the coming of the kingdom, as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, our crucified and risen Lord, who takes away our sins. Happy are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only my soul shall be. May the body and blood of Christ bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant Mary, who has journeyed from this world, may by this sacrifice be cleansed and freed from sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. If you'd like to be seated now, and we're going to invite Joan forward to say a few words.
I just want to start by thanking everybody for coming here today and being a great support to the family. I know Mom would have really appreciated everyone taking the time to be here on her final journey. There are a few people I would like to thank. Firstly, I would like to thank Father Kern and Father O'Gorman for such a beautiful Mass. Thanks to John Phelan for his support over the last few days. To all the nurses and carers, especially Aileen, Anne, and Sabrina, we thank you for being so kind and caring to Mom over the last 18 months. To Dr. Hogan, we thank you so much for your kindness you showed to Mom over the last number of years. You came down to her whenever she needed you. Day or night, it was no problem. We are so grateful to you. To my brother Mike and his wife Kathleen, thank you so much for taking Mom into your home and giving her such good care. And to my niece Emer and my sister Teresa, I don't know if Mom would have been with us for as long as she was without the care she got from both of you. You went over and beyond. I know she adored both of you so much and appreciated the care she got. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Joan, Mary's daughter. Losing our ma is a deeply painful experience. It comes with a hurricane of emotions, processing, and reflection. And I don't know if I could have gotten through it without the support of my family being so far away from home. There are no lessons in the art of being a mother, but if there were, Mom would have gotten an A+. She was the best mother myself and my siblings could have ever asked for. She always put us before herself. We wanted for nothing. If any of us ever had a problem, we knew we could have turned to her, and she would never have judged us, no matter what we told her. She supported every decision we ever made and was always very proud of her children. We have no doubt that Mom is in Daddy's arms right now, and they are reunited for eternity. He was the love of her life, and we knew they couldn't be apart for too long. Mom was born in 1932 to Philip and Catherine Conway. She grew up in Drumcondra, County Dublin. She was always very proud of where she came from, even though she had a soft spot in her heart for Kilkenny. She was asked by my dad when they were dating if she fancied living down the country. I guess that was Daddy's idea of proposal back then. She ended up in the Grove and eventually settled in Donoughmore, where she raised 10 children. When she settled in Donoughmore, her passion for baking began. After all, she did have 10 mouths to feed. She had dinner on the table 4 times a day, between Dad, school runs, and the siblings coming in from work. She was always on the go, just the way she liked it. She wouldn't have it any other way. She was never afraid to get stuck into the farm work also. When she was getting ready to go out and help Dad to milk the cows, she would stand in front of the mirror, put on her lipstick and her headscarf, because she said, "You never know who you might run into in the yard." That was Mom. When all of her children finally flew the coop, she decided to join the Walkers Club in Kilkenny, where she went to many countries, climbed many mountains, and made many amazing friends along the way. What made it even sweeter was that she had 3 amazing friends to accompany her. Her great neighbors and best friends, Bridget, Mary, and Anne. I'm sure they could sit around all day and tell stories from their days of walking with Mom. It made it even more enjoyable for her when she came down the mountain to get a cup of tea and a scone after a long day. Mam got a write-up in the Kilkenny People for a great achievement. She climbed Ben Nevis in Scotland at the age of 80, and she was so proud of her achievement, as we were also. She always made us so proud, and she was a great role model to us all. Mam had many hobbies. Her favourite being her weekly outing every Tuesday with Teresa to Kilkenny for a bit of retail therapy. However, this was Dad's least favourite time of the week. She would come home and say, "Mick, I got a great bargain today." And he would say, "It's only a bargain if you needed it." Before she left, she would put a flask of tea on the table, a few sandwiches, and an entire apple tart to keep them going throughout the day. This described Mom perfectly, always making sure everybody was taken care of. Mom, we will miss you forever. Would we know you are back with Dad and looking down on all of us and keeping us safe? I want to finish with a small message from my sister Mary, who cannot be here today as she is in Australia with her son Leamy after being apart for 4 years. We know you are listening in today, Mary, and we want you to know that we are thinking of you and love you. This is Mary's message to Mom. My heart is broken to be so far away today. Know that I am with you in spirit as I travel along the Pacific coast of Australia. Ma, every road I take, I think of you. Your love of travel and exploring new places I knew Dad wouldn't leave you behind for too long. Thank you for being the best mom anyone could ever ask for. Give my girls a big hug from me up there. And finally, I'm going to leave you with a quote from my mother. She was great for her quotes. This is the one that I think of all the time, as I'm sure my siblings do too. She always said, anyone that's having a bad day and feeling things aren't going your way, she used to always say, you know what you need to do now? Just get yourself behind yourself and push yourself along. That was Mom. We love you, Mom. Thank you.
One final story. Mary was a great admirer of the Queen. And when she visited Ireland back some years ago, she wrote to her to thank her for her visit. And she got a reply from Buckingham Palace. She was very delighted with that. Strange now that she's being buried just as the Queen is about to be buried. So we pray maybe she might now get to meet her face to face. We stand now for the final prayers. So before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister Mary. May this farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet Mary again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. I'm now going to sprinkle Mary's mortal remains with holy water, reminding us of our baptism in Christ. And then incense her body with sweet-smelling incense as a sign of respect, for in life her body was a dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. In the waters of baptism, Mary died with Christ. May she rise with him in glory to everlasting life. May our prayers for Mary rise like incense before the face of God. May he hear and answer them in his mercy. And our response is, receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to her aid. Hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to Abraham's side. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Mary, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him at the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings that you bestowed upon Mary in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward your people and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to Mary, and help those who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister Mary forever. In peace, let us take Mary to her place of rest.
Thank you.